Shame is a prison as cruel as the grave. Shame is a robber and he's come to take my name. Love is a redeemer lifting me off the ground. Love is the power where my freedom song is found. And there ain't no grave gonna hold my body down. And there ain't no grave gonna hold my body down. When I hear that trumpet sound, I'm gonna rise up out of the ground. Where there ain't no grave gonna hold my body down. Fear is a liar with a smooth velvet tongue. Fear is a tyrant always telling me to run. Love is a resurrection. Love is a trumpet sound. Love is my weapon, gonna take my giants down. And there ain't no grave gonna hold my body down. And there ain't no grave hold my body down. When I hear that trumpet sound, I'm gonna rise right out of the ground. There ain't no grave gonna hold my body down. There was a battle, a war between death and life. There on a tree, the Lamb of God was crucified. And he went down to hell. He took back every key. He rose up as a lion, setting us captives free. When there ain't no grave gonna hold my body down. And there ain't no grave gonna hold my body down. When I hear that trumpet sound, gonna rise up out of the ground. There ain't no grave gonna hold my body down. You walked out of the grave, I'm walking too. If you walked out of the grave, I'm walking too. If you walked out of the grave, I'm walking too. If you walked out of the grave, I'm walking too. Where there ain't no grave gonna hold my body down. And there ain't no grave gonna hold my body down. When I hear that trumpet sound, I'm gonna rise up out of the ground. There ain't no grave gonna hold my body down. Where there ain't gonna hold my body down.
Welcome to Easter morning worship. We're so glad you decided to join us. If you are someone who worships regularly at Sarah UCC or at Salem UCC, welcome. If you're somebody who just happened to find us this morning, just was cruising by and thought, I'll check that out, welcome. If you are somebody who just needed a place to worship, welcome. I'm glad you chose to worship with us here this morning. Of course, this Easter Sunday is unlike any Easter Sunday we've ever experienced. We're recording this in an empty sanctuary. You're likely watching this on a screen or in your home, hopefully surrounded by some loved ones, some folks that you are self-quarantining with. This year, our Easter is light on Easter bonnets and Easter eggs. The joy of this place being filled with joyful worshipers, but make no mistake, the church is not the building. And though this building is empty, we gather nonetheless to celebrate the truth that the tomb was empty too. In fact, the very first Easter was not in a crowded worship space with singing and praising. On the very first Easter, the disciples were locked in their house. It was dangerous for them to come out. So this year, we might get the closest taste we've had yet to what that first Easter was like. We want to continue to bless you with song. We want to pray together this morning. We want to hear the word. We want to receive a message of hope this morning. First, will you join me in this call to worship? Don't weep. Don't mourn. There is great good news. Put away your garments of mourning. Let the light of God's love flood into your lives. No more do we have to fear the darkness. It has been overcome by God's light. My friends, enjoy this music and enjoy this worship service on Easter Sunday. This morning. First of all, we want to thank God for this
this wonderful Resurrection Sunday, we want to thank God for His Son, Jesus Christ. You see, everything's been paid for because of this morning, that empty tomb. Let us be thankful that for that this morning. Well, this morning from Salem, UCC, we want to lift up Mike Burns this morning. He's battling possibly COVID-19. We want to lift up Bruce Petmeyer. He was involved in a farming accident the other day, and it's pretty serious, but he had some surgery, and he's on the road to recovery at home. We want to lift up John Landon this morning. He's dealing with some things. We want to lift up Mary Campbell this morning. She fell and broke her leg a few weeks ago. We want to lift up, we want to give joy and praise for Babe and June Harding and Babe Anderson. They both turned 90, and what a joy that is. From Sarin, United Church of Christ, Trent Wilkes asked that we lift up all funeral home professionals. During this time, it's so difficult. And if you've had a loved one pass away or just went to visit a friend or loved one during this time that has passed, you know it's very difficult. And they're making everything as comfortable as possible for folks. But keep them in your prayers. Kevin Kramer is at home. He's having some difficulty right now. He's having flu-like symptoms, and he's just being safe. He wants to stay home and take care of that. And in this time, you never know. So keep Kevin and Susan in your prayers as they deal with this situation. We want to lift up Mike Lannon. That's Joe Lannon's father. Joe or Mike had a pacemaker put in the other day, and he's also had some pneumonia. He had all this stuff done up in Indianapolis. He is home now recuperating with some care from the family. So keep the Lannon family in your prayers. And also they have a niece that's a nurse in Nashville, Brittany Dyer. Keep Brittany in your prayers. Mike Kelly, he's dealing with some pneumonia, and it's pretty serious, and I believe he's on hospice now. So keep Marcia and Mike and all the family in your prayers. We'll keep Dan Templeton in our prayers. He's dealing with some things right now also. And well, just let's lift up all health professionals right now. Everyone that is dealing with this COVID-19 has really changed some things. Healthcare professionals, nurses, firefighters, police officers, doctors, just pharmacists, those that are doing their essential jobs right now, the employees that are behind they're behind a little glass, and there's a little slip that you can slide your payments under back and forth. Those folks that are getting out there every day, we want to remember them. And those that are homesick, lift them up. And those that have God has called home, lift their families up, because it's difficult right now in the grieving when you can't be with a loved one. So I ask you to give all this stuff to God this Easter morning and praise God for birthdays, for the dinner you're going to have today with those loved ones around you. And if you're missing them, call that friend or that loved one up and just say, "Hey, I was thinking about you this Easter morning." If you would, I ask you to bow your heads and be in prayer. Gracious, wonderful, loving Father, Abba Father, as Jesus said, we come before you this morning as your disciples. As your disciples gathered together years ago, this morning they were fearful. They didn't quite know the good news to come yet, even though they were told. Gracious God, we know the news. We know the joy of this empty tomb and the resurrection. Help us to show that and live that. Lord, we lift up every single person that is dealing with this COVID-19 virus. The researchers, the doctors, the nurses, the aides, the patients, those that are delivering the test and doing the testing, those essential workers, Father, we lift them up. We lift up each and every member of the body of Christ, for they are the church. This building we're in, recording this prayer, delivering this prayer this morning to the church. This is the building, the body, the church. You hear our prayers. We lay all our stuff out this Easter morning, gracious God, and we believe. As we believe that Christ would rise from the dead, we believe that you hear our prayers and you answer them. We thank you for loving us so much. We thank you for this day. We thank you for victory in the name of Jesus Christ. We thank you for that empty tomb. And we thank you for filling our hearts with answers and hope and love. And we thank you for our Savior who is alive. He is risen. We thank you for the words that he taught his disciples, a way to pray, as we will pray to you this morning. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our sins, as we forgive those that sin against us. And lead us not to temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen and amen. Our God has heard our prayers. God bless.
How deep the Father's love for us. How vast beyond all measure that he should give his only son to make a wretch his treasure. How great the pain of searing loss. The Father turns his face away. Wounds that mar the chosen one bring many sons to glory. Behold a man upon the cross, my sin upon his shoulders. Ashamed I hear my mocking voice call out among the scoffers. It was my sin that held him there until it was accomplished. His dying breath has brought me life. I know that it is finished. I will not boast in anything, no gift, no power, no wisdom, but I will boast in Jesus Christ, his death and resurrection. Why should I gain from his reward? I cannot give an answer. yes, I know with all my heart. His wounds have paid my ransom. But this I know with all my heart. His wounds have paid my ransom.
Without question, we are living through some times that we will remember for the rest of our lives. Like the folks in 1918 who had to live through the Spanish flu and everything that changed about society for a period of time then. Like folks in a later generation who lived through the Great Depression and how much that altered the way of life, or World War II after, how the whole society had immobilized for the war effort. In my lifetime, the thing that is the most resonating thing for people my age, the thing that changed the most about our lives was 9/11. We had to adopt new security measures and think about the world differently and think about our safety differently following 9/11. And so, in 2020, we are living through a time that has changed the way we live. And we hope several things that we are not allowed to do now we'll get to do soon. But certainly it will never go back exactly to the way that it was. And I know some of us have anxiety around that and some fear around that. Some of us are very uncomfortable. Some of us aren't abiding well by all the extra time that we have to be at home. Some of us, like me, are people, and the need to be around other folks to get energy and to feel like they are connected to something greater. Some of us need community. But this is a time we'll remember for our whole lives. And this Easter Sunday, I hope, is an Easter Sunday that we will remember for our whole lives also. And one of those reasons is that this is the Easter Sunday that we're all going to stay at home and watch worship on a screen. JD's going to preach a sermon in an empty sanctuary. There is no one here in the building except me. I'm speaking to a camera that's stationed about midway through the middle pews here. It is surreal. I have known for a few weeks that we were going to have an Easter Sunday without folks. I knew this is where this was going, and I prayed that it wouldn't be the case, but I also prepared for it to be the case. What does it mean that the church is empty? What does it mean about the church? What does it mean about following Jesus? What does it mean for us? And I'm hoping that the answer to that is something that we'll remember for the rest of our lives. Will you bow your heads and pray with me? Gracious and loving God, we ask you to be with us. You have been with us already in our praying and in our singing and our gathering here this morning, Lord. And I just ask you to be with us, though we are not together in person, be with us together, gathered as the body of Christ virtually. Be with us as we watch this in our favorite chair or at the kitchen table or on a couch next to the people that we love. Be with us whether we are seeing this on Easter Sunday morning or later in the day or later in the week or sometime much, much later looking back. Lord, be with us. And use this time that we are setting aside on this Easter Sunday to worship you here. Use this time to speak to us clearly. Speak into our lives and speak into our fears and our anxieties. Speak into our discomfort, the disjointedness of this time. Speak into us, Lord. Challenge us and call us and show us how it is we serve and follow you. Speak to us, Lord. Open our ears and open our hearts to receive a word from you and let everything else just fall away. We pray in the one we celebrate having been resurrected this morning, Jesus. Amen. The scripture that we're going to read today comes from John chapter 20. We're going to read verses 1 through 18. This is the version of resurrection that we get in the Gospel of John. Keep in mind, the Gospel writer of John is an evangelist. He is trying to convince the reader that Jesus is the Messiah. And so his resurrection story centers on a little bit different version of events than the one we find in other Gospels. Listen with me, John chapter 20, verses 1 to 18. Early on Sunday morning, while it was still dark, Mary Magdalene came to the tomb and found that the stone had been rolled away from the entrance. She ran and found Simon Peter and the other disciple, the one whom Jesus loved. She said, "They have taken the Lord's body out of the tomb, and we don't know where they have put it." Peter and the other disciple started out for the tomb. They were both running, but the other disciple outran Peter and reached the tomb first. He stooped and looked in and saw the linen wrappings lying there, but he didn't go in. Then Simon Peter arrived and went inside. He also noticed the linen wrappings lying there, while the cloth that had covered Jesus' head was folded up and lying apart from the other wrappings. Then the disciple who had reached the tomb first also went in, and he saw and believed. For until then, they still hadn't understood the scriptures that said Jesus must rise from the dead. Then they went home. Mary, standing outside the tomb, crying, and as she wept, she stooped and looked in. She saw two white-robed angels, one sitting at the head and the other at the foot of the place where the body of Jesus had been lying. "Dear woman, why are you crying?" the angels asked her. "Because they have taken away my Lord," she replied, "and I don't know where they have put him." She turned to leave and saw someone standing there. It was Jesus, but she didn't recognize him. "Dear woman, why are you crying?" Jesus asked her. "Who are you looking for?" She thought he was the gardener. "Sir," she said, "if you have taken him away, tell me where you have put him, and I will go get him." "Mary," Jesus said. She turned to him and cried out, "Rabboni," which is Hebrew for teacher. "Don't cling to me," Jesus said, "for I haven't yet ascended to the Father. But go find my brothers and tell them, I am ascending to my Father and your Father, to my God and your God." Mary Magdalene found the disciples and told him, "I have seen the Lord." And she gave them his message. We gather on this Sunday, and I want to challenge you to look inside the story and figure out which kind of person you are in it. Because I think it will inform the way you feel about this Resurrection Sunday. It will inform the way you feel about the times that we are living in, that this Resurrection Sunday falls in. It will inform the way you feel about your own faith journey in these days. And maybe it will also inform the way you feel about the church. Because the church has a part to play on this day and the days going forward. The church has a part to play till the end of the age. And Jesus has promised he'll be with us that long. Because there are some people in this story who are asking the question, where is Jesus? They're asking to know where he's located so they can go and be with him. And I feel like there are some of us who ask similar questions. There are some people in this story who see Jesus or see the evidence of his presence, the evidence of his resurrection, and it's that causes them to believe. They have heard the word, and so seeing causes them to believe. I have seen folks like that. There are others who are encountering Jesus in this story, just like many of us who encounter Jesus in ours, and they do not recognize him. And yet others who don't know that they are standing before Jesus until he calls their name. I have seen some souls like that. We didn't realize they were in the presence of God until it became personal for them. I'm asking you today to listen for God speaking to you, to pay attention to whether you are encountering him, to believe once you see, and to hear in this story and in this message that you already know where Jesus is. We listen to this story or the stories in the other Gospels, and we hear of this idea that the grave has been conquered, that there is victory over death. It's love's victory. It's God's victory. It's the victory of that, of the one who chooses us over a full and long life. It's the victory of the one who chooses us, though we do not deserve it, and dies because of us, though he did not. We hear these gospel stories every Easter, but this is the first Easter ever that we have these two things present also. We have a virtual experience instead of a tangible one. And we're in the midst of a lot of unrest and anxiety, a lot of uncertainty, a lot of worry, a hyper-focus on our mortality, a hyper-focus on the things that can scare us, that await outside of our door. I want to think about those two things, but I first want to dial into this notion that's being introduced in this story. We have seen a couple of other people risen from the dead by Jesus. But in this story, the story that was always leading this way, the story that has lots of notes left for you, especially if you're reading the Gospel of John that we were hinted here. In this story, Jesus is resurrected by God who no one sees. Jesus is resurrected, and not in a miraculous way that people get to witness. They just find the evidence of it later, an empty tomb. The linen that was wrapping around him laid in a couple of spots. They see angels and they are given these signs, but it's a moment before they see Jesus himself. And when they do, he's already resurrected. It has already happened and he's standing among them. Here, he's standing and speaking to Mary. He'll later talk to his disciples. He'll later talk to other men on the way to Emmaus. He'll later have conversations with folks that get to see him, that ask to touch him. They'll be able to be given proof. Timothy Keller, who wrote the book, The Reason for God, and is a pastor in New York City, right on the front lines of scary times right now, wrote this in the book, The Reason for God. If Jesus rose from the dead, then you have to accept all that he said. If he didn't rise from the dead, then why worry about any of what he said? The issue on which everything hangs is not whether or not you like his teaching, but whether or not he rose from the dead. The main tenet of the Christian faith is this notion of resurrection, that life had ended for Jesus and death had won momentarily and the grave had conquered him and evil and darkness had won, and then all of a sudden light and love and goodness and God overcame those things and overcame those things for all time. It is in the resurrection that we get to experience new life. In fact, Jesus says that in John chapter 11, though they must have forgotten it as they watched him die, that he said, I am the resurrection and the life. It is Jesus' resurrection that empowers our baptisms. And when we are dropped in the water, our old life dies. And when we are pulled up, a new life begins. That new life is built upon a foundation of God's power over the grave, over evil, over darkness, over death. And that is all hanging on the notion of Jesus' resurrection. It's a hard thing to get your head around for sure, and doubt it if you must, but I think that is probably a very accurate depiction of the place where the rubber meets the road. Either Jesus was risen from the dead, he resurrected, and therefore everything he said before that has merit and value and is true, and we should cling to it. Or Jesus didn't, and he fades into history the same way several others would have before him and have since. He's a good guy who died a tragic death, whose message was love. There are even modern examples, though not uncomplicated, of the same thing. But it is Jesus' story that has echoed for now centuries, for thousands of years. About this day we are celebrating together, this Easter Sunday, this Resurrection Sunday. And as we sit in a world that is also changed and our way of life is greatly affected and is altered from the way it has ever been, as we sit and we are full of fear and anxiety, how could we not be? As we sit and we are craving for things to get back to normal, I have to tell you that there is a rhythm to life that Christians should understand better than anybody, and it's death and resurrection. that there's a rhythm to the way we understand the world because of this day, because of this story, because our Savior died and what God did with it was bring Him back and create a new thing. And so we, unlike many people who are engaging pandemic and engaging uncertain times, have to look upon this and know that God is going to use it to bring about something new. I stand in the sanctuary and none of you are here. No one else is here. It would be easy for someone's mind to take them, especially standing where I'm standing, to a future where the church dies. To a future where there are lots of churches that can't survive this time, just like there are several households who will hurt and struggle, several people who will hurt and struggle and not survive this time. It would be easy to come to the conclusion that the church will never recover from this. But that would be buying into only part of the story. That would be like rolling out of the Jesus story at the tomb. And we are people of the resurrection. We are Easter people. And so we have to always carry with us the promise of resurrection. So let me tell you what I see. I see a bunch of churches who were inching toward finding a way to reach more people through technology, but weren't terribly motivated for it, who have found a way to make sure that their services are streamed online, that they are also on social media, that they are also easy to find on YouTube, that you can watch church on your phone or watch church on your tablet or watch church on your TV or your computer at home. I see churches getting creative about how to reach people and how to bless people and how to serve people in ways that they would have had to fight and drag their feet and take years to figure out before we all of a sudden had to figure it out quick. I see a church like ours who has less than 200 people worshiping on a Sunday who now have at least 300 people viewing our Sunday morning worship. And I know some of those folks have 4 or 5 people sitting in the room. So I wonder what our reach is now. And I see a praise band concert that we shared have almost 4,000 views overnight at the beginning of this stay-at-home order. And I wonder how many people we have blessed that we never knew we could bless. I wonder how many people we can reach that we never could have reached. I see us helping to make sure that kids have food and making sure that folks get the blood they need and making sure that the blessing box is full. I see other people in our church sewing masks. I see other people in our church running errands up for people, making phone calls to people, sending cards to people, spending their time praying for people. I see folks doing their essential work and then at the end of the day finding other way to work. I know a guy who built an entire recording area upstairs in his house just so he could make Easter music happen for his church today. And that's just one church, one part of the body of Christ. Just in our community, I could list for you several other examples of churches who have been mobilized in a new way, who have found new life in this time where they have to do church differently. And trust me, all of those pastors can't wait till their sanctuaries are full again and they're preaching to live people and they get to feel the spirit that comes from us when we gather together. This guy chief among them, but we're all trying to find a way to communicate the good news through the means we have and the mediums that are at our disposal. And that's just in this town. Could it be that part of this old way that is dying in this pandemic, the old way of I gather at my church at the same time, the same place, in the same seat every week, is dying so that a new thing can be born? Is it possible that what is happening before our eyes is we're seeing that the church never really was the building, even if it's a beautiful building with lots of stories and lots of beautiful memories within the walls? What if we start to see this as just a place where we go to get recharged and refreshed so that we can go back outside into the world and be the followers of Jesus there, ministering to people and sharing the love of Jesus Christ and showing them what it looks like to follow Him? Isn't that more like the model that Jesus was trying to create from the beginning? And is it possible that God is using this death, this pandemic, this time that we are all facing that is so unusual, and that we'll remember forever, and He's showing us a new way to follow Him, a new way to listen for Him, a new way to encounter Him and recognize Him, a new way for us to see and believe, a new way for us to hear Him call our names. See, that is exactly what God has done over and over and over throughout history. He has let one thing die so that He could raise it up again and give it new life. See, the scripture I quoted earlier this week in a morning devotion is that Jesus Christ is the same yesterday, today, and forever. That scripture doesn't read, "The church is the same yesterday, today, and forever." It doesn't read that ministry is the same yesterday, today, and forever. This is at least the 10th time I've tried to preach the sermon to this camera alone in this sanctuary. I'm struggling to get my head around what it means to minister to a group of people who I have to encounter virtually. But what God keeps telling me, what God keeps making clear to me as I pray through this, is that this is just a greater opportunity for us to lift His name up and draw all men to Him. An opportunity that we wouldn't have had unless God was able to work resurrection where other people only see death. An opportunity we wouldn't have if God in His goodness didn't have enough love and enough light to shine in the midst of evil and darkness and death. That's the story of Easter. In her book, Searching for Sunday, Rachel Held Evans, who was with us last Easter and is not with us this Easter, wrote this reflection that has been on my mind as I've worked through what I needed to say on this Easter Sunday morning. I want to share most of chapter 32 of this book. It's only a couple pages, I promise, with you. It speaks directly to what I'm trying to say to you this morning. Her words. In 2013, a megachurch pastor, famous for his controversial antics, arrived to a Sunday evening worship service at his church in Seattle in a long black hearse. Dressed in formal funeral attire, he posed for waiting photographers before going inside and preaching a sermon about how the church in America is dying and it's up to Christians to revive it. A few weeks later, his book hit the shelves, complete with a hearse and sepia tones gracing the cover. It has become popular in recent years for Christians to speak of the impending death of the church. Conversations at denominational meetings and Christian conferences are sotto voce as conversations around the dinner table about how this may be Aunt Marie's last Christmas, so we might as well let her racist comments slide. The alarm is not completely unfounded. Polls show the percentage of self-identified Christians in the United States has fallen from 86% to 76% since 1990. The percentage of people claiming no religious affiliation has doubled, rising to 16%. Young adults seem especially disinterested in faith, with nearly 3 out of every 5 young Christians disconnecting from church life after age 15. I confess to citing these numbers ominously myself from time to time, especially when I want to make a point about how millennials are losing faith in the church over issues related to politics, sexuality, science, and social justice. I may have uttered something along the lines of adapt or die in my writing once or twice. I may have jumped the gun and administered last rites. But lately I've been wondering if a little death and resurrection might be just what the church needs right now. If maybe all this talk of waning numbers and shrinking influence means our empire building days are over. And if maybe that's a good thing. Death is something empires worry about, not something gardeners worry about. It's certainly not something resurrection people worry about. G.K. Chesterton put it this way, "Christendom has had a series of revolutions, and in each one of them, Christianity has died. Christianity has died many times and risen again, for it has a God who knows the way out of the grave. I don't know exactly what this new revolution will look like, but as the center of Christianity shifts from the global West to the global South and East, and as Christians in the United States are forced to gauge the success of the church by something other than money and power, I hope it looks like altars transforming into tables, gates transforming into open doors, and cure-alls transforming into healing oils. I hope it looks like a kingdom that belongs not to the rich, but to the poor, not to the triumphant, but to the meek, not to the culture warriors, but to the peacemakers. If Christianity must die, may it die to the old way of dominance and control and be resurrected to the way of Jesus, the way of the cross. As the shape of Christianity changes and our churches adapt to a new world, we have a choice. We can drive our hearses around bemoaning every augur of death, or we can trust that the same God who raised Jesus from the dead is busy making something new. As long as Christians are breaking the bread and pouring the wine, as long as we are healing the sick and baptizing the sinners, as long as we are preaching the word and paying attention, the church lives. And Jesus said, even the gates of hell cannot prevail against it. We might as well trust him, since he knows a thing or two about the way out of the grave. New life starts in the dark, writes Barbara Brown Taylor. Whether it is a seed in the ground, a baby in the womb, or Jesus in the tomb, it starts in the dark. What if what is happening before our very eyes? What if what you are participating now by watching this worship service on a screen, not in the worship space where I am? What if what is happening is God reconciling the church to the world, using the mediums that young people and all people have in their pockets and at their disposals to 24/7 reach them with the good news of Jesus Christ, to use these technologies that we have long drug our feet to embrace, to find a way to lift the name of Jesus, to draw all men to him? What if what we are watching before our very eyes is the dying of the way of the church as it used to be? And new life in a new way of us seeing who we are and what we do. Less tethered to the walls around us and more focused on the people we might reach in the world, wherever they are, whenever we encounter them, however they come to hear our message. I know it creates more anxiety in you to think about what life looks on the other side, if not for the comfort of our pews and our church and the spirit of sharing. And trust me, I have no desire to lead us in a way away from that. In fact, every day I long more for us to be back together in this room, to fill up this room with our shared voices and our shared experiences and our shared gratitude to a God who got us all safely through this. Make no mistake, what I'm saying is that let's gather together the next time we get to gather together, understanding that these walls which we've had to stay out of for the last however many days, they can't contain what God is doing with us as a church, with us as individual followers of Jesus Christ, and especially with all of us together connected to the wider body of Christ. On my social media page, in the last couple of weeks, I see lots of chatter about God, lots of chatter about Easter, about Jesus, about the church, lots of chatter about what is going on in the world and do we need to turn now to God. Lots of chatter that I didn't see 3 or 4 or 5 weeks ago. And I can't help but see that it's good. I can't help but see that it's exactly what God has always done. Used darkness and death. Used devastation and disaster. as the jumping off point for goodness and love, for light, for His glory, for His victory. We live in a world that is changed. And for now, it's changed in some profound ways that are personal, as we're asked to self-isolate and social distance, as we are kept from one another. But what if what God's going to do with these changes that were imposed upon us is use them to create a church that sees the world and sees its neighbor in a new light, not bound by the four walls around us as we worship, but instead those four walls merely a sanctuary for us to recharge our batteries, to go out into the world and to love it. Not bound by just what gets said here when the room is full, but a church that sees these mediums that we're using now to communicate as part and parcel of a ministry that will exist beyond these days, as just as important in the way we build relationships with one another and the way we build relationships with Jesus Christ as it was before, when we could greet each other and shake one another's hand and walk side by side physically. Because the generations that these statistics that were just quoted are missing, the group of people who are not in the church, are exactly the group of people who need a new way for the church to engage them, who need a new way to find that truth and hear about Jesus' life and death and resurrection. Maybe how God is using this time is to find exactly that way. In the book, The Fight Club, Chuck Palahniuk has this line that I've always remembered: only after disaster can we be resurrected. Folks, there is a day coming, and I'm so excited about it. It's the first Sunday that we get to be here all in this room. It's the first Sunday that we get to come out of quarantine. We get to be closer than 6 feet apart. We get to have more than 10 people in a room together. We get to be the church in the church. The very first Sunday that happens, it's going to be a mighty celebration. It's going to be a powerful witness of God's love, and the Spirit that will be with us. We call it the Spirit of Sharon here, but it's the Holy Spirit, and it'll be everywhere in all churches on that Sunday. I'm so excited about it. But don't forget, when that Sunday arrives, how much God has showed us when we weren't able to be together on Sundays. Remember, on whatever Sunday that is, what you've learned on this Easter Sunday, and the Sundays that we've been virtual before, and the Sundays that will be virtual subsequent to this one. Remember that the gospel message and God's love isn't bound by four walls. Remember that in the midst of all of this fear and anxiety that seems to be seeping out of every pore in every direction, God continues to show us, continues to prove to us, that love will always win. That love has had a victory once and for all. That love has won forever. At this moment we celebrate today, this empty tomb, remember, on the days after this Easter Sunday, that there once was this Easter Sunday, and you sat in a room by yourself or with a few of your loved ones, and you had to think about what life looked like following Jesus if it wasn't inside the walls of a church. Because why that is important, because why I long for it daily, it was never the point of following Him. Perhaps this disaster can lead to our resurrection. Perhaps this death might be the exact way that we find a new life in Christ. Perhaps it is this day, disjointed as it is, that we understand we have new opportunities to follow Jesus, to be His disciples in this world, to take care of it and love it and mend it and share the good news in it. So I invite you this morning Whether you're someone who is looking for Jesus and can't seem to find him. Whether you're somebody who has seen him and therefore believes. Whether you're one of those people who may have encountered him but didn't recognize him. Or whether you're one of those people who is listening for him to whisper your name. However you encounter this Easter Sunday, whatever your relationship looks like with Jesus, I hope it's growing and developing in this time you have more Sabbath than usual. I challenge you all to carry with you in the next several days and weeks and months and years, to carry with you from this day forward for the rest of your life, the promise of resurrection. That there is no lasting darkness. That there is not an everlasting death. That the grave is not the last word. That evil does not triumph. Our victory is in Jesus. Love wins every time. The grave is not our final destination, but rather a glorious paradise. The light shines in the darkness, and the darkness has not overcome it. Jesus is the resurrection and the life. I invite you today to try in every way you can to know him better. I invite you today to try in every way you can to grow in your understanding of who he is. I invite you today to show in every way you can the love he has shown you. The way we say that here, before we sing a song to close our worship, the way we say that here is to articulate the mission statement of Sarah Church, which is to know, grow, and show the love of Jesus Christ. May you do so as this Easter season begins and continues through this unusual time. Be blessed.